Hello everyone, I, Preeti Roy, your physical science teacher, am here again today to discuss the topic Organic Chemistry, chapter number 8, and in your page it is 130, right? So today we will start with Organic Chemistry introduction. Under introduction, there are 2 points that we will discuss. One is vital force theory and second is the timeline of organic chemistry. Now to start with chemistry. Chemistry is incredible science, right? Why do we call it incredible science? Because it is science of almost everything, right? Starting from stars, me, you, sunlight, photosynthesis, even burning of fuel. Whatever comes into our mind comprises of what? Chemistry, right? And out of this chemistry, there is one very interesting branch that is called as organic chemistry. Now this word organic, the word organic itself is giving you a hint that what does it mean? The word organic means organs, means living. So what is this organic chemistry all about? When did it evolve? When was it developed? All this we will discuss today in this particular chapter. So now this organic chemistry, it was not developed within a research of just few years work or maybe 100 years work. It is very from the very beginning of the civilizations that when human beings, they started discovering, when they started learning the science, from that time it has initiated, right? Again, like the thing which wakes you up in the morning, what is that thing? You have your tea, I have coffee. So what does it contain? Caffeine. That caffeine which gives us a kickstart, what is that? That's an organic compound. Now if we talk about where is this organic chemistry, are we using it in our daily life? Yes, very much. Right now, you are seeing this video in your mobiles, right? The mobile case, your mobile, the cameras, the telescopes, the pipes, the cables, this even marker, the structure, the ink, it contains what? It contains the organic compounds, right? Now this organic chemistry, it actually, if we say when was the study of organic chemistry started, it dates back to very early of 19th century. Before that also, as I said, there were civilizations who were using these organic compounds, but they didn't have so much of idea. The actual study of organic chemistry, it started from 19th century, early 19th century. Now, if I talk about early civilization, people that time were using this Ayurvedic medicines, right? From the very early stage, they were using willows, they were using this poppies, tulsis. They knew that they have certain medicinal values and they were used to cure certain diseases. But what actually it contains, that particular compounds which are present inside this particular substances, those are what? Nothing else but organic compounds. Again, I just said, today if we look anywhere around us, more or less everything is made up of what? Organic compounds. Again, like as I said, the chemistry is an incredible science. It is everything that which we can imagine of. What is chemistry? Nothing. It's just an atom. It's breaking, it's combining with another atoms, its reactions, its properties, that is only chemistry, right? And in chemistry, organic chemistry, one branch. And this one branch is so vast and incredible, right? So that is what we will discuss in this particular chapter, that what are the features that make this particular organic chemistry so interesting and so vast? what is actually organic chemistry, when was it developed, how was it developed, right? So to start with, what is organic chemistry? As the word organic itself means what? From living things. So organic chemistry is the study of, what is it? It is study of structure, properties, composition, reactions and preparation of carbon containing compounds. So in short, what is organic chemistry? Organic chemistry means the substance which are formed from carbon. Their structure, what are their basic properties? What is their composition? Now carbon just cannot be alone, right? So its reaction and how they are prepared. Now this preparation, it can be natural and it can be man-made. So all included in this particular organic chemistry. Before 18th century, it was believed that organic chemistry or the organic compounds cannot be synthesized in laboratories. Okay, so it was thought, like as I said, early civilizations, they were using these organic compounds, but they did not have much knowledge about it. So what was the notion or what they thought? That organic compounds are present in all the organisms and it is due to some kind of a vital force, some natural force, that only living beings, only living organisms, they can synthesize organic compounds. In labs, we cannot prepare them. That is why they were segregated, separated from other elements, and it was Berzelius. It was Berzelius who gave the term organic chemistry in the early 18th century, in 1806, when he was doing different studies, analytical studies on compounds of carbon and hydrogen. That time he differentiated these compounds and he said that the compounds which come from organisms are called as what? Organic compounds. And the study of those organic compounds is called as what? Organic chemistry. So the term organic chemistry was coined by whom? It was coined by Berzelius in the year 1806. So again, there is one interesting, very interesting story related to organic chemistry which I want to share with you. Actually, now early civilizations, we know they had a vast knowledge, but in-depth knowledge was not there related to the organic compounds. They were using different organic compounds for medicinal properties and also for the dyeing purpose. If you remember in your history, you must have studied indigo, the dye indigo, right? So indigo was a dye which was used to color the clothes. Now there is one substance that was used to make the color attach to the cloth, and to enhance the color of the dye, there was one component that was used, and that was urine. It is believed that in Greece, right, what happened, they used to do what? To dye the clothes, they used to add little amount of urine to the clothes. Thank God we do not belong to that civilization period right now, otherwise our clothes must have urine. No, not now. So this urine, what it was thought that time, that is an organic compound and it cannot be synthesized in the lab, right? So what now, from where this urine used to come? This urine was in such a demand that people, yes, people used to sell their urine at that time. And again in Greece, there was a tax which was levied on it. But what happened, there was one collector, Woodrich Wooler, what he did in the lab, he synthesized this particular urea, right? Now this urine contains a compound called as urea, which was used along with the dye. Now, what is the purpose of using this urine? Urine is actually like a bridge which is between the cloth and the color. So because of this urea which is present in urine, that the color used to fix on the clothes very nicely, and the color used to be very shiny and very pleasant color used to come, right? So that was the main purpose of using urine. But it was Friedrich Wöhler who synthesized this urea in the laboratory, and that was the time when this notion was broken. This hypothesis, the huge big hypothesis that organic compounds cannot be synthesized in the labs, was abolished. So it was who? It was Friedrich Wöhler who synthesized what? Urea in the lab. And he developed this urea from what? An inorganic compound of ammonium cyanide, which we will study little later. So this was the story, right? Now, so do you find it interesting? Isn't it? This organic chemistry, organic compounds are everywhere. Right now, you are watching me in your mobiles. The mobile also has organic compounds. Forget about everything. Right now, you are able to see me. I'm able to see you. I'm able to see all these things. Why? Because my eye contains a compound called retinol, which converts the light rays into optical waves, right? So this particular retinol, which is present inside my eyes, is also an what? Organic compound. So this is the beauty of organic chemistry, right? And why is it so unique? What makes it different from inorganic chemistry? All that will be discussed in this particular chapter. Okay, so once again, let us start. What is organic chemistry? Organic chemistry is the study of structure, properties, composition, reactions, and preparations of carbon-containing compounds. Now, this particular definition includes both man-made and the natural, right? Because earlier, before 19th century, what it was thought that organic compounds cannot be synthesized, right? It is just present inside the organisms, right? Because organisms, they have certain vital force inside their body through which only living organism can synthesize the organic compounds. But it was Friedrich Wöhler, right? Friedrich Wöhler, in the year 1828, he developed the very first organic compound, urea, from ammonium cyanide. And that time, this hypothesis was a setback, right? So if a question comes, what is organic compound, I would request you to write this particular definition. Why? Because in this particular definition, it includes both the man-made plus the natural organic compounds. So again, once again, what is organic chemistry? Organic chemistry is the study of structure, properties, composition, reactions, and preparation of carbon-containing compounds. Now, what is vital force theory under the introduction chapter? As we have already discussed, vital force theory was prevalent before the early 19th century, and it was the organic chemistry, organic compound term was coined by Berzelius, right? So before that, early 19th century, what was considered? That organic compounds cannot be synthesized in the lab. Human beings, they are not man-made, and they cannot be made by human beings. They cannot be derived from inorganic compounds. It is just because of some kind of a vital force, some force which is present inside the organisms, through which only organisms can synthesize the organic compounds. So this is called as what? Vital force theory. And who coined the term organic chemistry? Berzelius. All right, now I will request you to make a note of this definition, and then write down, if you see, I am writing this point wise because this chapter is a little lengthier. So we will go point wise so that it becomes easy for you to understand. So first thing what I have started with, I started with introduction. Introduction is first point. Under introduction, what I have discussed right now is the vital force theory. So please just write down the definition and point one, vital force theory. So what is vital force theory? Again, I'm saying, before early 19th century, it was considered that organic compounds cannot be synthesized in the lab, right? So it is due to some vital force that only living organisms can synthesize these organic compounds. That is called as what? Vital force theory. In your book also, if you take out your book, page number 130, you will find it postulates, underline this third paragraph, it was postulated that living system possesses what? Vital force, which is necessary to synthesize organic compounds, right? And as it was thought that it is only organisms which can make the organic compound, so almost no efforts were ever made to produce this, or to synthesize, the right word is synthesize, these organic compounds in the laboratory. Now please make a note of this definition and write down vital force theory. After that, I will discuss the timeline with you. So far, we have discussed what is the definition of organic chemistry, what is vital force theory. Now, under introduction, we are going to discuss the timeline. What do we basically mean by timeline? In your Facebook also, you have timeline. That means different events. So what I have done, I have categorized the different events that took place in the study of organic chemistry. As I earlier also mentioned that this organic chemistry, the study of this organic chemistry did not develop in a years, right? It took centuries of work to finalize this beautiful work of organic chemistry, and it is one of the most beautiful part of chemistry. Now, this organic chemistry can be a little bit tricky, difficult, but if you understand the basic concepts, this is the most easier part of your chemistry. Now, we are moving towards the timeline. As I already discussed with you, that before the early 19th century, also during ancient civilizations, people were using these organic compounds, but they did not have a very basic knowledge, right? From 18th century onwards, they started using the organic compounds, and from 19th century, there was a different branch for the study of these particular compounds, and Berzelius, he termed it as organic chemistry. Now, till 19th century, it was believed that organic compounds cannot be synthesized in the lab, right? So now if I tell you that there is no need to study, you will clear your exams. So will you study? No, you won't study, right? The very similar way. Now when the concept was there that organic compounds cannot be synthesized, it is just because of the vital force which is present inside the organisms, they can synthesize the organic compounds. So more or less nobody paid any heed towards the development, towards the synthesis, towards the properties of a detailed study of these organic compounds. But what happened, as I was telling you the story of urine, which contains what? Urea. And this particular urea was used where? For the purpose of dyeing, right? So Friedrich Wöhler in the year 1828, What he did, he synthesized urea in the lab. And before 1828, before the work of Friedrich Wöhler, it was considered that urea, which is present in urine, it can never be synthesized. It is just the living organisms who can synthesize this urea. So he conducted a very beautiful experiment of ammonium cyanate. He took an inorganic compound, which is ammonium cyanate, right? This is inorganic compound. He did it and it got converted into what? Urea. This is what? Urea. And this particular reaction is called as Wöhler's synthesis. So if a question comes, one mark question, what is Wöhler synthesis? So what is Wöhler synthesis? Wöhler synthesis is the reaction which was conducted by Friedrich Wöhler, in which he took ammonium cyanate and it was decomposed into what? Urea, which is CO within brackets NH2, hold to this bracket close, 2, right? So this particular reaction is called as what? Wöhler synthesis. And it was conducted by whom? It was conducted by Friedrich Wöhler. And this is the giant step that was taken by Friedrich Wöhler. Why it is called as a giant step? Because it gave a fatal blow. It gave a fatal blow to whom? To the vital force theory. You know, even when initially when he conducted this experiment and he synthesized urea in the lab, he was very scared to disclose it into the public. Why? Because of this vital force theory, which was very much prevalent at that time. So he thought, if I go and say that I have synthesized urea, then what will be the effect of people will start thinking me that I have gone mad, I have gone crazy. So what he did, he initially did not disclose this particular reaction. So later on, when he disclosed this and he proved that no, urea can be synthesized in the lab, and that even from an inorganic compound, ammonium cyanate. So it gave a fatal blow to the theory which was very much prevalent of before the early 19th century. And what was that theory? Vital force theory. So now this vital force theory was what? Abolished, abandoned, right? Because what did it say? That organic compounds cannot be synthesized in the lab. But now it is synthesized in the lab. It's a proof, right? So it was abolished. And as I said, it was a very big step towards the study of organic chemistry. Why? Because once it was proved that yes, we can manufacture or we can synthesize organic compounds, then one after the other scientists, they started studying on it, and more they started giving time to the organic compounds. So after 1828, it was Kolb. In the year 1844, he synthesized what? Another organic compound, acetic acid. After that, in the year 1854, it was Perry Barthelot. He did not stop. He made many inorganic compounds in the lab, starting from your fats, your different kind of acids, right? So it was Perry Barthelot in the year 1854. He started synthesizing n number of organic compounds. After that, it was William Henry Perkin in the year 1857, and he made a very important dye called as Perkin-Mills dye. And again, this Perkin-Mills dye, again, it's very important. And this particular timeline, is also very important in the study of organic chemistry. Why? Because actually it happened accidentally. William Henry Perkin was synthesizing quinine, medicine quinine, and accidentally he synthesized one dye, and the name of the dye was given Perkin mauve dye. And this fetched him good amount of money. He made many, financially he became very strong and he earned a lot of money, and then it was click. Okay, with this organic compounds, it is not just related to study and investigation and properties and dealing with them, but if you are really good with it, you can fetch a good amount and you can become financially strong. So it was William Henry Perkin, and he synthesized Perkin mauve dye in the year 1856, right? And he became very financially strong, and he opened the doors for everyone so that everybody, like, if interested in organic chemistry, they could synthesize different compounds and can fetch good amount also. Then in a year 1858, it was independent work of Kekule and Cooper, that when they were studying about the properties, that why organic chemistry, organic compounds, they are so interesting, so elaborated, what is the actual property, what is the uniqueness of organic compounds. So in the year 1858, they found out, they gave the term catenation. They gave the term catenation. What is catenation? Actually, carbon has a property that it combines with another carbon, and that property is called as catenation, and we will discuss catenation little later, right now only. So who termed the coin catenation? By Kekule and Cooper in the year 1858. Then important step that came in the study of organic compounds was in the year 1874, Lavoisier. So Lavoisier, he investigated different hydrocarbons and he studied the combustion of different hydrocarbons, and he came to the conclusion that these organic compounds, they contain what? Carbon and hydrogen. So these 2 years and these 2 names are also very, very important that you should remember. So the term catenation came in the year 1858 by Kekule and Cooper, and it was Lavoisier in the year 1874 when he investigated and performed many tests on the properties of hydrocarbon. He concluded that the compound hydrocarbon is actually the compounds of carbon and hydrogen. So what do we see? That the whole year, the 19th century, the complete 19th century belongs to the period of what? Organic chemistry. And it didn't stop there only. Today, right now, we have more than 50 million compounds of organic compounds. Daily, new compounds are synthesized, studied, their properties are discussed, because as I said, this field is very, very interesting, right? So again, the timeline starts from 1806. It was Berzelius who coined the term organic compound. 1828, Friedrich Wöhler, he synthesized urea in the lab from an inorganic compound, ammonium cyanide, and this particular reaction is called as what? Wöhler's synthesis. And it is again very important step, a giant step towards the study of organic chemistry. Because of this particular Wöhler synthesis, there was a fatal blow to the old theory, which considered that organic compounds can never be synthesized in the labs. Then Kohl, in the year 1844, in the lab he synthesized acetic acid. 1854, Pierre Barthelot, he synthesized many organic compounds in the lab. Again, one important step came in the year 1856 when William Henry Perkin synthesized a dye which fetched him a good amount. And then commercialization of organic chemistry started. Then 1858, it was Kekule and Cooper who gave the term catenation to show that why organic chemistry, the organic compounds are so unique, because they possess a property called what? Catenation. What is catenation? When one compound, the carbon has a tendency to attach with another carbon and to form long chains of carbon, that is called as what? Catenation. And in the year 1874, it was Lavoisier who proved that the organic compounds are actually the compounds of what? Carbon and hydrogen, right? So please make a note of this particular timeline.